This is Pope John Paul II, the 263rd Pope of the Roman Catholic Church, a man who presides over a church of 750 million, a man who sometimes leads where others may not wish to follow. When he lands in Quebec City September 9th to begin his Canadian tour, he'll have served as supreme pastor to his worldwide flock for almost 6 years. It will be the first time a pope has ever visited our country. Why has he come? What does this visit mean to the Canadian Church? And what will be his message? We'll try to answer these questions while in conversation with Archbishop Joseph McNeil of Edmonton. Archbishop McNeil was president of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops when they first extended the invitation to John Paul to visit Canada, and he's been intimately involved in the planning ever since. We'll also take a little bit of a different look at the Pope's relationship to Canadian Catholics and the Canadian Church, and review the practice and understanding of papal authority. Let us first familiarize ourselves with what the Canadian bishops feel are the key points, objectives, and possible outcomes of the visit. First of all, any visit by the Pope is an event. This event will mean different things to different people. The visiting Pope may be seen as one who is bringing Catholics together in a huge assembly, or as a spiritual leader of a great religion, or as a special witness to the Christian way of life, or as an expert on humanity, or as head of a small state. The bishops stress that first and foremost, this is a pastoral visit. The Pope comes not as head of state, but as a pastor of Catholic people. Another key element in the visit is dialogue. The community which welcomes the Pope is not merely a passive group. It is a community which sees itself as responsible for Christian life. It wants to be a welcoming community. It wants to enter into dialogue with the visitor. The Church in Canada will speak to the Pope and to the Church Universal in uniquely Canadian symbolic gestures. So there we have our three key points to remember about the visit of John Paul. It is an event, it's pastoral, and it's dialogue. Why the emphasis on the pastoral nature of the visit? Because first, that will allow us to express our faith. This visit is a unique opportunity for preaching the gospel in the special context that is Canada in 1984. In addressing the themes of the visit, which we reviewed in part 3 of this 5-part series, the Pope will be proclaiming the faith which is both his and ours. Secondly, the visit will allow us to celebrate our faith. The Pope is coming here not to be celebrated, but to join us in a celebration of faith, to celebrate with us. Celebrate our faith, the general theme for the visit, implies that Canadians and the Pope together will celebrate the risen Christ in a way that is at once spectacular and profound. And thirdly, the visit of the Holy Father will surely challenge us to renew our commitments, to deepen our commitments, and even to adopt completely new commitments in faith. So there we have the objectives of the visit as outlined by the Canadian bishops: the opportunity to express our faith, to celebrate our faith, to commit ourselves to action. And what do the bishops hope this visit will accomplish? A strengthened faith commitment. The Pope comes to strengthen our faith. He comes to make welcome ordinary people, the poor, the underprivileged, the rejected, and to recognize, encourage, and support them in the faith, and to give them new hope, like those who first heard Jesus speak the Beatitudes. His visit will mean a deepening of faith. It will add to our confidence, call us to repent and to be reconciled, and help shape our growth in faith. Hopefully, the visit will intensify our desire to be at the service of the faith, to lead believers to new commitments and to renewed commitments. Finally, the bishops hope it will help us during this holy year of reconciliation to reach out in brotherhood and with great respect to those who live apart from the church, including those who describe themselves as non-believers. And to the marginalized, the wounded, the young who are far from church, we must let them know we are open to them and we want to be reconciled with them. Archbishop Joseph McNeil of Edmonton was president of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops when the invitation was first made to John Paul to visit Canada. Recently, I talked with the Archbishop about the event and what it means to us.
I suppose one of the first things would be that as a result of his visit, each one of us will be better people, that he will touch our hearts. You know, we have a bit of an inkling of that in the visit we had from Mother Teresa of Calcutta. I think she touched many, many people in a beautiful way. I think the Pope John Paul II would do the same thing. I think that our opportunity of sharing him with other people, you know, it'll be a visit to all the people in Alberta and really Saskatchewan and part of the North. So we're sharing him in a way, our great gift, our great leader is being shared. And I think that will, as you indicated earlier, my expression of bringing us to a certain degree of maturity, I think that the fact that we will pray together the evening prayer on the Sunday evening at the cathedral, that we will have our clergy from all over the province and from Saskatchewan, that we will have representatives of the religious women, that we will have representatives of the various denominations, various religions, and to be led in prayer by the Pope. To me, I think that's just going to be a beautiful experience for us, and I think it will help us understand, probably in a very forceful way, how important it is for us to pray together. I said to him, what would you see as a kind of important preparation by our people for your visit? And he thought for a moment, and his answer wasn't exactly on what I was asking in a way, but he said, the visit that was best prepared of all the visits I've had so far was the visit to England. And he said, I felt that when I was there, that I was being received by all the people. I felt that it was a visit, a friendly visit to all the people, not just to the Catholics. And I think that's the way he would like to consider his visit here, that somehow that all of us here in Canada and all of us here in Alberta receive him as a most important and famous guest who can inspire us, who can lead us in prayer and lead us in service. Anybody who wants to come to the Mass or the Eucharistic celebration there will be certainly welcome. And we would hope then also that we will give him an opportunity to go. Go through the crowd and have a chance then to be very close. Visit for 99% and 44%, 100% of our people, that just no thought that they'd be able to get to Rome and to be close to the Holy Father and to be able to share in Mass with him. And here he's coming to us.
Here it is, here
and now. Yeah, it's just a fantastic gift to us, to be able to. He's coming to Alberta and even coming to Edmonton. That's beautiful.
That ecumenical gesture in support of church unity is indicative of a central fact of the papacy of John Paul. His appeal crosses all denominational boundaries. He belongs not only to the Catholic Church, but to the world. The man in charge of planning for the Edmonton visit told me that he's had many non-Catholics volunteer to help, and in the words of one of them, "Don't forget, he's our Pope too." The Canadian visit of John Paul II should confirm and strengthen the fine ecumenical dialogue that already exists in this country. It's an event intended for all peoples of every faith. I asked Archbishop McNeil how we all might prepare for the visit and the messages the Holy Father will share with us.
An obvious way is that we try to understand his teaching, what he has been saying all along, how he wants us to live, how he wants us to relate to one another. And he has given lots of evidence of that. I think this, again, this whole notion of preparing by prayer, by asking the Lord to bless this visit so that many hearts will be touched, and that many of us will reach out to others, because for all kinds of reasons, many people, maybe most people, are hurting, are in need of love and care and compassion. And I think that perhaps in preparing for his reaching out to us, that we should begin to do more of that ourselves. And I think that we will feel that this is kind of a crowning of our own efforts to allow the Lord to act through us, to touch people who are hurt. You know, I would like to think that the great things that are being done by many people to help those who are unemployed now, and people who are suffering in many ways, with winter coming on, there so many people are very concerned and very upset, and a lot of our people are trying to reach out to them, trying to help and try to understand. I think that's a preparation for being able to celebrate with this person who himself reaches out to so many.
There has been criticism of overly exposing Pope John Paul II to the stresses and strains of journeys such as this one to Canada. He carries a workload and a responsibility unique in the world, and one that can be both physically and mentally demanding, even for a healthy pope of 64 years. Others have criticized the money needed to underwrite an event of this kind. They suggest the money might be better spent providing food and aid to starving people in third world countries, like Ethiopia. Archbishop McNeil acknowledges that these are valid concerns.
I'm sure that the Pope himself had to make a decision. Do I stay hidden behind big doors and barricades so that nobody will shoot me again? Or do I just simply go out among the people and let the Lord look after? In a way, he's quite comfortable in walking around without any security. But everybody else says we can't let that happen. So it's a terrible dilemma for someone like him to be in, to have to decide that if he's going to continue to go and meet people all over the world, that it's going to cost money.
And when all is said and done, and when questions of protocol and money are put aside, and the papal visit is placed in the spiritual context in which it really belongs, what then does this visit mean to the Church in Canada?
Well, I think what it means that in so many ways our Church has been a struggling missionary immigrant church. And to have the head of our church to come and to celebrate that same faith with us, in that sense, I mean that it's a maturing for us. I think it helps us understand that we're part of a much larger church, and we're part of a much larger people. And I think it will mean a great deal to us too that many people who are not of our faith will be with us, will celebrate with us, will share with us, because many people have said to us, well, we think he's our Pope too. And I think that will bring a certain degree of maturity to us. And I think it will help us understand in a much deeper way, and maybe a more universal way, the sense of our faith.
Let's now take a little time to talk about the relationship between the Pope and the Canadian bishops, and by extension, the Pope and the Canadian Church. For me, that's easier said than done. How does one easily explain a relationship between the Pope and the Canadian Church? It's as varied as there are Canadian Catholics. Do we try to fit it all into one neat package and wrap it all up with a multitude of bright bows and ribbons? Or do we review the structure of the Church and perhaps conclude by saying that his is a shared authority with our Canadian bishops? I should perhaps tell you that I'm a church broadcaster here in the Edmonton Archdiocese with the responsibility of producing a weekly television show that is broadcast locally and carried across Canada by satellite. I try to reflect, to the best of my ability, the diversity of the Edmonton faith community. Now, as I struggled with these questions, one incident in my work kept coming back to me. One day I was sitting in the office when I received a telephone call from an obviously angry lady. She had heard that I was going to feature, as a guest, a well-known church theologian with whom she violently disagreed. Now, I don't think the reasons are important. I tried to explain to her that this was just one program, and he was just one guest, that I had also featured people ranging from Mother Teresa to an activist priest in the North, and issues of church unity all the way to death and dying. But that didn't matter. I was going to get an earful anyway. It looked like, unfortunately, the only way I was going to terminate this conversation was to hang up, and I didn't want to do that. She paused at this time, and in a tone of rather apologetic resignation, said, "I know how I must sound, but if you only knew." She went on to tell me how she felt betrayed and rejected by the Church. The Vatican II renewal had left her behind, and liberated theologians just made her pain and anguish even worse. But those words stayed with me, "If you only knew." As Church, we must know. Each of us must reach out to those who feel separated from the Church and welcome them back. My lady caller must know she's just as essential and just as important as the theologian. And I hope one day that she'll come to cherish a church that can accommodate such a wide variety in the proclamation of the good news, which is Jesus Christ. And I hope that those who see the church as an active agent of social change will always find time to appreciate what this lady appreciates, the rich tradition and deep symbolism which is the Catholic Church. Isn't it wonderful that we have a church that can be a home to so many? I hope I remember this when the Pope comes to Canada, and I hope I don't try to fit him into my own view of church, because if I do that, he can't help but disappoint me. Because he's part of this worldwide mosaic, just as you and everybody else is. He brings his own personal story, and he makes us all the better for it. I have never lived in a country under Nazi oppression, but he has. I have never lived within driving distance of those monuments of man's inhumanity to man, the Nazi death camps we know as Auschwitz and Treblinka, but he has. I have never lived under communist oppression, but he has. I have never had to fight for my church to keep it from being suffocated by a repressive totalitarian regime, but he has. John Paul has grown up on the hard rock of adversity, and this is the special quality he brings to the papacy and the church. Just as my lady caller reminds us again of the tradition and symbolism of the church, while my activist friends proclaim a caring church for the contemporary 80s. So when John Paul comes to Canada, he comes as all of us and each of us. He comes to be with us and to share with us. If you have an opportunity to share in one of the magnificent masses he will celebrate across Canada, take a look at who is on the platform with him. It will be the bishop of your diocese. There is deep significance in this. As the bishop represents his diocese, the Pope represents what we might call the larger worldwide diocese. By sharing the stage with a bishop, The Pope is telling us that he too shares in this diversity and welcomes it and affirms it. This shared celebration serves to highlight the teaching role which the bishops of Canada share with the Holy Father in their own dioceses. It is also a reminder to us of the collegiality which has been such an important part of the church renewal since Vatican II. Maybe you've heard about collegiality but weren't quite sure what it is. Now you can see it for yourself. John Paul is here in a spiritual role to proclaim the living gospel in a preeminent way. He's a living sign that we are all one in Christ. Our togetherness is symbolized by the Pope, and as he reaches out to us, he challenges us to do the same, to reach out to others. My lady caller, the lonely couple next door, the family down the street trying to make do on welfare, the men and women trying again to share in the dignity of work. If we reach out as John Paul reaches out, we'll understand what he means to our Canadian church and how we all fit into it. I guess it isn't something you can easily put down on paper or even adequately convey on television as I'm trying to do. We're talking about a living, loving, shared relationship, a relationship in which we'll get out of it what we're prepared to put into it. John Paul leads the way and challenges us to follow not in his footsteps, but in the footsteps of all that comprise the Catholic Church, John Paul, the bishops, all of us. And he gives us the courage and faith to take the first step. Now, this may not have been the examination of papal authority you were expecting, and for that I apologize. Another program in this series, Papal Authority Through History, should fill that need for you. I'm Barry Hawkins. Saying that all roads lead to Rome. If this is indeed true, then conversely, those same roads must lead from Rome. The years following the conclusion of the Second Vatican Council in 1965 have blessed us with two popes who believe those roads are there to be traveled, roads that can take them to the extended family of the worldwide Catholic community. As jet travel is a creation of the 20th century, so are the papal pilgrims we know as Popes Paul VI and John Paul II. Never has the papacy been so visible than during these last two decades. Pope Paul VI started off in January of 1964 with his visit to the Holy Land. In his words, "We shall see that blessed land whence Peter set forth and where not one of his successors has returned." Paul was to walk where Christ walked and meet with Patriarch Athenagoras, the leader of the Eastern Church. The world saw in that meeting a visible promise of the unity that might someday be after a 900-year separation. That kind of visit has been carried on by Pope John Paul II, and on a scale that even Paul may never have dreamed of. As Paul was a pope of firsts, so is John Paul, the latest being his visit to Canada in 1984, the first time a pope has ever visited our country. It's not the first time for John Paul, however. While Cardinal of Krakow, he visited Edmonton in 1969 to take part in celebrations of the Polish community. We must not think that Popes Paul VI and John Paul II are the only popes who ever traveled great distances during their pontificates. Let's go back in history and quickly get acquainted with some of our earlier pilgrim popes and the reasons they took to the road. And remember, that was during a time when the world was much wider than it is today. By the way, my criteria for a traveling pope is any pontiff who travels outside of Italy. In the middle of the 11th century, the church found herself with many internal problems. Church offices went to those who could pay for them. Emperors and counts openly bought and sold bishoprics and the papacy. It was also a time of lax morals within the church. The rule of celibacy was not only ignored, but openly flouted by many in the church community. For many priests, it was a time of mistresses and marriage. Pope Leo IX resolved in 1049 to examine firsthand the morals of the clergy and the functioning, or dysfunctioning, of his church in the major cities of Europe at the time. He traveled to Verdun and Reims in northeastern France and Cologne in Germany in order to straighten out his wayward clergy. When he returned to Rome a year later, Leo IX had single-handedly, by his travels, restored respect for the papacy and the church. To make sure it stayed that way, Leo made further visits to France and Germany in 1051 and 1052. The onset of the Crusades that same century brought us our next traveling pope, Urban II. From March to October of 1095, Urban toured northern Italy and southern France, rounding up support for this venture to a far-off land. While in France, he gave the most influential speech of the Middle Ages and concluded with a ringing call to papal arms. That royal city, Jerusalem, he said, implores you to come to her aid. Undertake this journey eagerly for the remission of your sins and be assured of the reward of imperishable glory in the kingdom of heaven. While crowd after crowd and city after city roared back, God wills it, and the campaign for the Crusades was on. All in all, Urban was on the road and away from Rome for 2 years. Some popes seem to have little choice in the matter. The 68 years of the Babylonian captivity of the popes at Avignon, just outside the southeastern boundary of France during the 14th century, was just such an instance. Another would come over 4.5 centuries later when Pope Pius VI traveled to Austria to plead with the emperor to moderate his attempts to regulate the church in that country. Pius was not able to change the emperor's mind, but the crowds loved him, and he stayed a month in Austria before returning to Rome. In 1804, we have Pius VII traveling to Paris to participate in the crowning of Napoleon as emperor, and then a few years later being exiled by that very same Napoleon to Fontainebleau, 30 miles south of Paris, during the emperor's seizure of the Papal States. It would be 1814 before Pius would return to Rome to the unrestrained joy of the populace. I think it's fair to say that many of these early papal journeys were substantial undertakings for the time, considering modes of transportation and the dangers involved in such long trips. They were visits to re-establish papal authority, as in the cases of Leo IX and Pius VI. They were visits to put in place the machinery to raise money, as with Urban II and the Crusades. Or they were enforced journeys to dilute papal authority, as in the case of Clement V and the Avignon papacy and Pius VII's exile from Rome early in the 19th century. The journeys of our modern day popes are more pastoral in nature. They are a visible affirmation of a positive world attitude by the post-Vatican II Catholic Church. It's significant that the first journeys of Paul VI were undertaken during the years of Vatican II. The Holy Land and India in 1964, New York and the United Nations in 1965. Paul saw such journeys as part of the Pope's apostolic ministry in modern times. In his words, the Pope is a pilgrim, which means a witness, a shepherd, an apostle on the move. Paul's Christmas message for 1964 seemed to sum up this new papal mobility. He said, "We could have remained an isolated foreigner surrounded only by our brothers in faith." Then in so many words, he went on to say, but we didn't. Once again, we see the spirit of Vatican II, its emphasis on lay involvement in the church, a reaching out to the world to minister to it and learn from it. It's said of Paul VI that the poverty he saw during his visit to India left a lasting impression on him. Incidentally, it was during this trip, while on the plane to India, that Pope Paul held the first ever real papal press conference on record for reporters. The following year, he traveled to New York to address the United Nations. It is said his preoccupation with world peace irritated some members of the Curia and other Vatican officials. They felt he should be directing his attention to the deliberations of Vatican II and leaving politics alone. Pope Paul, of course, disagreed. As he pointed out in his speech to the United Nations, the Church has been on a pilgrimage in search of a conversation with the entire world ever since the command was given us to go and bring the good news to all peoples. Now you are here representing all peoples. Allow us to tell you that we have a message, a happy message, to deliver to each one of you and to all. That message was simple. The UN is the last hope for world peace. In Paul's words, no more war, ever again. Paul then went on to plead for disarmament as a first step toward peace. Pope Paul may not have tangibly altered the course of world events, but what he did accomplish was to bring to the support of the United Nations the entire weight of the Catholic Church, and some would say, the entire strength of Christendom. It was a visible sign of a new and caring church. Then came the televised open-air mass at Yankee Stadium before the largest crowd ever assembled there. In baseball terms, it was a grand slam. People had never experienced a pope like this one before, or been so close to one. Paul's outstretched arms of greeting signaled a new world-embracing church. Here was a pope ready to go anywhere for the glory of the church and the peace of the world. In the Holy Land and India, they had cheered the office, not the man. In America, he found himself genuinely loved not only for what he was, a pope, but for who he was, a man called Paul. Those close to him say that Paul was deeply moved by the outpouring of affection that greeted him in America. Paul VI would make other notable journeys during his pontificates. He would travel to Portugal in 1967, Colombia in 1968, Uganda in 1969, and to the Philippines and Australia in 1970. In every case, he was the first pope to have ever visited these countries. His role was that of a prophet of peace and justice to all peoples. No pope had traveled so far to bring that message to the world. The attack on him in Manila by the mad painter dressed as a priest, for all intents and purposes, marked the end of these papal pilgrimages, which would not be renewed until the succession of another pope with a similar world view. Pope John Paul II has continued Paul VI's role as an apostle on the move. His first journey after becoming pope signaled to the world that here was a man who would call him as he sees him. This would be a pope of orthodoxy and traditional values. On his 1979 visits to Mexico and the United States, John Paul seemed to sound more like a judge than a pastor. He put the church on notice that liberalizing tendencies among the clergy had no place in the church of John Paul II. He would have little patience with the liberation theology of Central America, or those who would like to see changes in the church's position on such issues as birth control and divorce. In these early journeys, John Paul made it clear that he came not to listen to excuses, but to expect obedience. It would take a little getting used to. Some were saying that John Paul had a one-world view of the church, but in retrospect, that judgment appears to have been premature. For this is the same pope who traveled to England and Argentina at the height of the Falklands crisis in 1982, trying to end the fighting and start the talking. He showed wonderful adaptability while doing this. To England, he came in an ecumenical spirit of peace and reconciliation, ending a 450-year-old breach between the Church of England and the Roman Catholic Church. His reception there exceeded all expectations. Organizers had predicted that 1 million people would turn out to see him in London, and they got 3 million. To Argentina, John Paul came, as he said, as the pilgrim of difficult moments, continuing the message of peace and reconciliation he had carried throughout Britain. There was no room for war in his gospel of peace. In John Paul's own words, "Each time we risk a man's life, we trigger mechanisms that could lead to nuclear catastrophes." Here was a pontiff with a message. Here was a pope determined to make any wayward regime with whom the Holy See had diplomatic ties recognize the true worth of liberty, respect for life, and for the dignity of persons, all reflecting a spirit of reconciliation and an openness toward spiritual values. To England, John Paul had come as a pastor, to Argentina as a head of state. This explains in part the different approach he brought to each country. Sometimes the Pope travels to distant countries as both head of the Vatican City State and as universal pastor of the Catholic Church. To others, as in England, he comes as a fellow bishop in the service of Christ. As a head of state, John Paul diplomatically must walk a fine line. In England, he did not visit Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher because she serves as head of government only. In Argentina, he could not make the same distinction with Leopoldo Galtieri, who then was both head of state and head of government. In order to avoid any misunderstanding, the Pope made it clear that this trip was an exceptional one, totally different from a normal apostolic pastoral visit. However, there still remains considerable confusion as to the different responsibilities and duties of the Pope, partly caused by this dual role as head of state and supreme pastor. For our purposes, it should be adequate to say that John Paul is both a pastor and an international statesman, and that enables him to talk to states on equal terms. But we must also remember that his is a kingdom not of this world, and that diplomatic activities of the papacy take place in this context, as do the remarkable journeys of Pope John Paul II around the world. Of those journeys, his two visits to his homeland of Poland stand out. The first was in June of 1979. Echoing memories of an earlier time, John Paul declared to his countrymen, "The Pope could no longer remain a prisoner of the Vatican, nor," he seemed to imply, "of totalitarian governments." A Polish pope was telling the world that after 30 years of communist oppression, the Polish church would never abdicate its responsibilities. These were words of hope and comfort, not only to his fellow Poles, but to everyone living under tyranny. The pictures speak for themselves. John Paul's next visit to Poland came in June of 1983. 8 days that would challenge a changed Poland, a Poland under martial law, a Poland of a banned trade union called Solidarity, and a charismatic leader named Lech Walesa. To a nervous government, he said, "I come in order to be with my compatriots at a particularly difficult moment in the history of Poland." To his countrymen, words of encouragement. "Perhaps at times we envy the French, the Germans, or the Americans, because they are so easily free, while our Polish freedom comes so very dear." A revealing comment by the Holy Father, and a reminder to us of the high price the Polish people and their church pay to survive the brutal pressure of the Communist Party. That visit, the 18th foreign pilgrimage since becoming Pope, underscored the moral authority of the papacy. Initially, the government refused to let him meet with Lech Walesa. It backed down after John Paul insisted on the session. In a land of martial law, John Paul had evoked Christ's words in Matthew chapter 25, verse 36. "I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. When we look back on the papal visits of Paul and John Paul, we can see many similarities and some notable differences. First of all, the similarities. Both have shared a concern about nuclear war and world peace. Paul went to the United Nations in 1965 to speak on peace and disarmament. John Paul, of course, went to England and Argentina at the height of the Falklands crisis in 1982. Both have been very supportive of church unity. Paul met Patriarch Athenagoras, leader of the Eastern Orthodox Church, on his visit to the Holy Land in 1964. John Paul met with the Archbishop of Canterbury in England in 1982. Both have made extensive use of television and other media. Paul's Mass at Yankee Stadium during his visit to New York in 1965 was seen by 100 million people. And of course, John Paul, as we know, is warm and natural on television, but we must remember that that charisma is based on his own faith and, of course, on the world's search for faith. There is a tragic similarity. Both have been victims of attempted assassinations. Paul in Manila in the Philippines in 1970, and of course John Paul in St. Peter's Square in 1981. And one other similarity, when you see John Paul land in a country to begin a visit, the first thing you'll see him do after he comes down off the plane is to get down on his hands and knees and kiss the ground. This is not entirely spontaneous. His aides have studied the earlier journeys of Paul VI and found that this was a widely accepted gesture, and Paul was the first to do it in Bogota, Colombia in 1968. Differences between Paul VI and John Paul II may be most notable in areas of social justice. Both, of course, have been deeply touched by third world poverty, but John Paul draws the line as to how far the church should go in trying to correct these abuses that are seen there. He sees the church's mission as being to right social wrongs, but only according to Christian principles. It's the laity, not the clergy, that must seek social change by political means. Paul was uncomfortable with the outpouring of affection that he was met with during his journeys. John Paul, on the other hand, he seems energized by it. And another difference, Paul saw himself as a pastoral pilgrim. John Paul does too, but he doesn't hesitate to bring to our attention what he sees as abuses in the church and how they might be corrected. Another difference, John Paul has involved the Holy See in world affairs and diplomacy on a scale unprecedented in church history. He has forced the church to squarely face the harsh realities of life outside the Holy See, such as the man we call Pope John Paul II, and like Paul VI before him, an apostle on the move. Pope John Paul II is coming to Canada at the invitation of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops and the Canadian people. While here, he'll address specific issues of concern to the Church in Canada. In this program, we'll try to outline these issues by exploring the 10 proposed themes of the Canadian papal visit and comparing them with major themes of earlier visits to Central America, the United States, England, and Poland. We'll look at the reasons John Paul made these visits, the context in which they were made, and what messages he brought with him. And what he said then may give us an idea of what he might say today. During production of this program, I should add that the Canadian bishops announced some changes in the schedule and topics of the Pope. Please keep in mind that other changes may be forthcoming in the weeks and months preceding the actual visit. John Paul made his first visit to Poland as Pope in June of 1979. It was a jubilant occasion. Poland's favorite son, who had left 8 months earlier as a cardinal, was coming home as the first Polish pope in history. The visit came amid growing signs of a new boldness among the faithful of the Catholic Church of Eastern Europe. John Paul's message was one of hope and encouragement for those involved in this revival. It was an uncompromising proclamation of the Christian view of man, that Christ cannot be excluded from man's history anywhere in the world. In the Pope's own words, the search for solutions which will enable human societies to cope with the task confronting them and live in justice is perhaps the main sign of our times. A mere priest saying this would have been thrown in jail. For Poland is a country where the thousand-year-old Catholic Church is leading the resistance against communism, and in the process, becoming a symbol of national pride and lost freedoms. The quiet defiance of the country's communist rulers by the Pope and his people during this first visit would help to prepare the way for Solidarity, the first independent trade union in the communist bloc. John Paul's next visit to Poland would come 4 years later, in June of 1983. The main religious purpose of this trip was to celebrate the 600th anniversary of the Black Madonna, Poland's holiest icon. He hoped the pilgrimage would serve truth and love, freedom and justice, reconciliation and peace. For this was a changed Poland, a Poland of martial law, the banned Solidarity, and until recently, the imprisoned Lech Walesa. Whereas the mood in 1979 was joyful, in 1983 it was somber and pessimistic. The Pope said, "I come in order to be with my compatriots at a particularly difficult moment in the history of Poland." His tour of the country was a carefully calculated blend of defiance and caution, acknowledging the reality of martial law, but speaking out against the misery and injustice it had caused. To a divided nation, the Pope's visit was a call to faith, hope, and endurance. John Paul II had been Pope for 1 year when he visited the United States in October of 1979. Here was found one of the largest and active Catholic churches anywhere, and to the Pope's concern, one of the most liberal. John Paul's message was more that of a judge than of a pastor. He restated traditional Catholic doctrine and came down hard on materialism and what he called permissiveness. As examples, he talked of women's ordination, priests and nuns in non-clerical garb, and pro-abortion movements. It seemed he had come not to argue, but to state, not to listen, but to give orders. The Pope was genuinely hurt and dismayed by his reception during his six-city tour of the United States. In truth, John Paul may have been the victim of bad advice from those closest to him. He may also have been the victim of bad press. The Columbia Review of Journalism wrote that media coverage of the trip was the worst abdication of journalistic objectivity in the history of the United States. There would be other journeys to other parts of the world in the years to come, but this visit to North America would remain a deep source of hurt and pain for the Holy Father. The central theme of the papal visit to England in May of 1982 was in fact four themes. John Paul came firstly as a pastor to celebrate the first Mass ever celebrated by any pope on English soil. But he was also there as a guest, a brother bishop. He also had come as an ecumenical peacemaker to help heal a 450-year rift between the Anglican and Catholic churches. And finally, John Paul had come as a prophet of peace to a nation at war with Argentina. History was made not only at Canterbury, when for the first time a reigning pope visited the cradle of Christianity in England. History was also made when the pope signed a declaration establishing a new ecumenical commission, inaugurating a new relationship between the Catholic Church and the Anglican Communion. Taken in total, we might say the overall theme of the English visit was reconciliation between the two churches, between man and God, between man and man. John Paul's visit to Argentina the following month can almost be considered in some respects an extension of the English visit. The Pope brought to this South American country the same message of peace and reconciliation he had carried throughout Britain, for this was the country with whom Britain was at war. The Pope came to Argentina, as he said, as the pilgrim of difficult moments. It was an appropriate phrase, well earned during his trip to Britain and even more so in Argentina. Unlike the British visit, however, this was a political pilgrimage. The Pope made that clear when he termed his visit an exceptional one, totally different from a normal apostolic pastoral visit. John Paul had come in a spirit of healing and reconciliation to an Argentinian church divided over the invasion of the Falkland Islands, or as they were called in Argentina, the Malvinas. The Holy Father emphasized the healing and counseled his clergy to avoid political involvement. John Paul's 1983 journey to war-torn Central America was one of peace. He declared one should be with those who suffer. John Paul came as a pastor, offering strength and solace to his Central American flock of 25 million Catholics. His was a message of hope, peace, and unity. For this is the world of El Salvador, Guatemala, and Nicaragua. It was also a journey to once again remind the clergy of their priestly obligations and not to neglect these in order to serve the state. It was a journey of loving gestures and hard words, reminiscent of his earlier papal journeys to Mexico and Brazil. Predictably, reaction was mixed, and it was a journey of apparent contradictions. Even though critical of what he calls liberation theology, John Paul visited the tomb and praised the example of Salvadoran Archbishop Oscar Romero, gunned down by rightists in 1980 while saying Mass, and considered a martyr by the liberation movement. So this, then, was a pilgrimage of peace, concord, and hope, and a rejection of the ideologies of both right and left. Referring to United States and Soviet involvement in El Salvador and Nicaragua, but without naming them directly, John Paul stressed that it was important for each nation to confront problems in a sincere dialogue without foreign influence. John Paul's 8-day tour of Central America placed the Catholic Church solidly behind the struggle for peaceful social change and offered courage and hope to a suffering flock. And now John Paul comes to Canada, the first time a pope has ever visited our country. The general theme of the Canadian visit is celebrate our faith. In a pluralistic society such as ours, there are many ways to do this. One way is through reflection in preparation for the papal message, and the bishops have come up with some topics to help us. We remind you that the Canadian Church, like other Catholic churches throughout the world, can only suggest topics that John Paul might like to speak on. What he'll say about these themes is entirely up to him, and he's been known to pull a surprise or two out of his papal hat. We'll follow closely the suggestions contained in document number 1 of the Spiritual and Pastoral Preparation for the Papal Visit, as supplied by the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops. It should help us to better understand the general and specific themes of the upcoming papal visit, as recommended by the Pastoral Planning Desk. First of all, let's look at the general theme, Celebrate Our Faith. In the words of the Canadian bishops, to celebrate means especially to welcome someone whose kindness has been given most freely. It can also be, as many have suggested, a time to welcome back parishioners who have stayed away too long. To celebrate our faith during the Pope's visit is to join with him as people of God in welcoming Christ in a more spectacular and yet more profound way. To celebrate is to recognize that Christ has been the Lord of our past. To celebrate is also to call upon the presence of Christ so that in the future our community might manifest the glory of God through commitments to justice and brotherhood. The help of Christ is help given by the servant who has come to serve and not to be served. Among those who share in this service of Christ to our community, the Pope is surely exceptional. He is, to echo the words of Pope Gregory I back in the 6th century, the servant of the servants of God. Now let's look at the different ways the Pope is expected to help us celebrate our faith and the challenges he may present to us as he travels across Canada in September. Remember, only the topics of the Pope's speeches are known in advance. The speeches themselves will not be released prior to his arrival in Canada. Our first general topic is faith and culture, and the Pope is expected to speak on that during his stops in Quebec City and Winnipeg. This, along with the other three themes, which are on God, missions, and Mary, we can categorize as the faith experience. When we think of faith and culture, we see many having difficulty in believing today. There is a substantial loss of the Christian sense, even disaffection with religion, while a secular mentality prevails. The young person in Paris who asked John Paul, "What is this God in whom you believe?" has counterparts among Canadians. In our modern world, which is secular and pluralist, new ways of thinking and living are developing. The church invites us to rethink and restate our faith. The Pope will talk further on the faith experience in Montreal and Vancouver, where he will give a major thematic discourse on the mystery of God and his presence in the hearts of all people of goodwill. The mystery of God is first of all the mystery of his presence, expressing itself as the Word in the heart of each person and community. The voice of the Pope, as it has so many times before on other journeys, should bring hope and consolation to Canadians. The Pope can help us in the continuing effort to focus our vision on the action of God in our lives by recalling with us the heritage left by the saints in this country. In Halifax, John Paul will explore the faith experience even further when he talks on the mission of the Church throughout the world. The Christian community is a missionary community which invites people to share its experience of God. The mission field, once thought of as existing only in foreign lands, is now to be recognized as existing in our own land. Missionary activity abroad faces a particular cultural challenge. It must define itself in relation to socioeconomic development and challenge that development with the gospel's demand for justice. Missionary activity at home has its own particular challenge in that it must find ways to call people to belief within a secularized society. At the Marian Shrine of Cap-de-la-Madeleine, Quebec, the Pope will dwell on love and devotion to the Virgin Mary. Mary is ingrained in the Polish past of John Paul, and for him, an essential support in his responsibility for preserving faith and morals, a reminder of the historical consciousness and doctrine of the Church. The Pope will speak on faith as a social experience when he talks of the Church as community in Moncton, New Brunswick. The experience of faith is a social experience. Faith is received in community, expressed in community, celebrated in community. The parish is a privileged place of faith, as it is in the growing number of faith communities. These serve to enhance the religious experience of people for whom the parish seems inadequate. At the same time, the parish serves them as a link to the larger community. The family, the smallest of communities, finds in both the parish and the new faith community a milieu in which to live its joys and a support in its difficulties. Within the parish structure, more and more people are participating in ministries. A commitment to co-responsibility of priests, religious, and laity in the life of the believing community is characteristic of our Canadian Church. We celebrate this development. Our next six topics fall under the category of faith as an experience leading to justice, truth, and love. These include the family, Native peoples, Canada, third world relations, peace, and technology and the human being. Family will be the topic of the Pope's message in St. John's, Newfoundland. It is in uniting itself with other families, rather than by acting alone, that the family will accomplish its tasks in the Church. In the same way, families can meet the challenge of building a society of love, justice, and truth. Faith can be experienced in a special way in the family, in the healing of hurts between husbands and wives, parents and children, children with the family, families with other families, the divorced and remarried with the church community, the parish family, the diocesan family, the Canadian church family, They're all social expressions of faith. At every level, a continuing demand of faith is that one accept to pardon and to be pardoned. During his stops at the shrines of St. Anne de Beaupré near Quebec City and the Canadian Martyrs at Midland, Ontario, John Paul will meet Native people, as he will if arrangements can be completed for a visit to the Northwest Territories. With the arrival of Europeans in this land more than three centuries ago, there began a continuing project of trying to relate to new brothers and sisters. In this relationship, there have been successes and failures, and for any inappropriate action on her part, the Church asks pardon. Today in Canada, there are signs of a rediscovery of spirituality specific to various groups of natives. Reflection on these spiritualities in the light of the gospel and by the natives themselves will enrich the religious heritage of this country. Canada is among the nations where there is being raised the question of land rights of native people. By responding to this question in a spirit of justice and truth, Canada can lead the world community to genuine reconciliation with native peoples. The Third World will be the focus of John Paul's major address when he visits Edmonton. Seen through the eyes of faith, the world community shows no one people as superior to another. In the Christian view, there is only one vine, Jesus Christ, and we are, all of us, the branches. Solidarity with the poor, solidarity with the oppressed, are for Christians answers to God's invitation to live in faith. That there is a third world, a grouping of nations around the one fact that their economies are fragile, is a challenge to the whole community of nations. The morally sensitive will recognize that justice is a fruit that is rarely being harvested in the field of world economy. The Church in Canada must be resourceful in finding ways to offer herself as a beacon of hope for the poor and oppressed in Canada and abroad. And she must make Canadians aware of the problems of human rights and economic injustice in the world community, particularly in the third world communities. In Ottawa, the Pope will speak on matters concerning world peace, including the threat of nuclear war and the responsibility of governments to ensure that this never happens. Before us is the scandal of arms expenditures, dwarfing expenditures on meeting people's needs, the scandal of growing militarism that represses human rights, the scandal of war being waged in the midst of innocent men, women, and children. At the same time, there is the reassurance of Jesus Christ, "My peace I give to you." We are living in a world of unequal relationships maintained by economic and political structures which are centered on particular interests rather than on the common good. These structures are failing to effect justice for all. On the other hand, there are those heroic persons and groups who are inspired by principles of justice, truth, and love. These are the builders of a world that can enjoy peace. Pope John Paul II's major address in Toronto will be on technology and the human being. And when we think of technology, we think of work. Work, paid, unpaid, or volunteer, is activity which is essential to being human and essential for the enhancement of community. Justice in the marketplace rests on the principle that the worker is the subject of work and not just a commodity. Faith can aid the worker in building a world of justice, truth, and love. John Paul stressed the dignity of human labor and the priority of labor over capital in his 1981 encyclical, On Human Work. These principles were further amplified in 1983 by the Social Affairs Commission of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops in their document, Ethical Reflections on the Economic Crisis. On the subject of technology and communication, there is much to reflect upon in preparation for the Pope's remarks. Technology is easily regarded as a triumph of human ingenuity. Its chief value, however, is that it enables us to see more clearly and more fully the reflection of the divine Creator. It enables us to be more intelligent and more responsible stewards of creation. Technology and communications has brought the world to the doorstep of the information age, where the fund of human knowledge can be made universally available. A back and forth flow of information can enable all to recognize in themselves both the learner and the teacher. With today's means of communication, knowledge need no longer be the domain of a few persons or of a few nations with the consequent power over others that this implies. We need to take the time to reflect on the role of technology in community and family life. Canada, already a world leader in information technology, has much to contribute in formulating principles for its use in building a world based on truth, justice, and love. When Pope John Paul II comes to Canada, he'll be visiting a church which sees itself as a pilgrim people trying to live in the spirit of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This church loves the world in which it lives and wants to bring hope to it. The papal visit will mirror the achievements, failings, and challenges of the Canadian church. In this way, it can add to our confidence, call us to repent and be reconciled, and help shape our growth in faith. It will truly mark the coming of age of the church in Canada. It may also go a long way to healing the divisions in this country as the papal pilgrim brings his message of hope and healing to us in September, such as the man we know as Pope John Paul II. Anyone who has ever studied or taught church history, the title of this presentation is, to say the least, challenging. There are many aspects to any examination of the role of the Pope through history. There's the spiritual, the political, the sociological, the governmental. Our dilemma was to decide whether to attempt covering all of these dimensions of the papacy in a program of some 20-odd minutes, or to select just one of them and give it the in-depth treatment it deserves. We've opted for the latter, and we'll devote this presentation to an examination of the development of papal authority from early Christian times to the present day. It's a facet of the papacy that has implications not only within the Catholic Church itself, but outside of it as well. And I feel it's essential to any understanding of the role of the Pope through history. Hopefully, at some later date, we can give the other dimensions of the papacy the attention that they too deserve. We'll begin with the early Christian times and Peter, whom we traditionally refer to as the first Bishop of Rome. We'll go on to highlight changes in the papacy brought about through Constantine and the beginnings of state religion. We'll also look at the development of the Vatican States, the centralization of the Church, and the doctrine of papal infallibility. We'll conclude with a brief examination of the modern papal office, one which embodies greater collegiality, ecumenism, and mobility. The popes will be reviewed in the context of their times. That'll mean a journey into the history of the times as well as the papacy, and that can be, as my father might say, a testy proposition. It's not without some justification that the 19th century British statesman Lord Acton once gave advice to those about to write history. He said, "Don't." Well, with apologies to Lord Acton, we're going to tempt fate and try to weave our way through what some would say is a theological minefield. Hopefully, we'll come out of it relatively unscathed, but it'll be a challenge. By the time we're finished, I hope we have a greater appreciation of the difficulties of the developing church, a better ability to judge and understand the historical situation in which she found herself, and a realization that history is made up of people who struggled as we struggle today, even popes. If we approach it from that point of view, we'll find we have much to be thankful for. By the way, the word pope, where does it come from? Well, it comes from both the Greek and the Latin. In Latin, it means papa, father, and was in early times used in the West of any bishop. It wasn't until 1073 that Pope Gregory VII restricted the term pope solely to the Bishop of Rome. Now let's see how the role of the pope has developed over almost 2,000 years. Catholics believe that the papal ministry is the continuation of the ministry that was given by Christ to Peter, and which is exercised by his successors in the Roman Episcopate. For the first 300 years, the Christian Church was a loose network of local churches with a common allegiance to apostolic tradition. During this time, the Bishop of Rome was increasingly called upon to settle disputes in other local churches. The Bishop of Rome was considered preeminent. The local churches all had something else in common: persecution at the hands of the Roman Empire. The rulers saw the young Christian church as a threat to the routine of command, obedience, discipline, and duty they expected of every citizen. And the first duty was obedience to constituted civil authority, not church authority. If it was to survive, it was imperative that the young church define itself and proclaim conditions of membership. It needed a scriptural canon, a doctrine, and authority. But who should have the last word on church doctrine? Who should be the final authority? By the end of the 3rd century, Christians in Rome numbered about 100,000 and were beginning to claim for their bishop universal authority in the church. Also, other bishops of the far-flung church acknowledged, for the most part, the primacy of the Bishop of Rome, though they continually challenged his power to overrule them. Meanwhile, they and their faithful were still being persecuted by rulers that demanded a clear-cut choice of allegiances. You could choose either Caesar or Christ, but you couldn't have both. Or could you? In the 4th century, there happened on the scene a Roman emperor who would give the church its freedom. His name was Constantine, and he was the most powerful monarch of his time. Constantine and his immediate successors made Christianity the state religion, and soon most of their subjects embraced the new faith. It marked the replacement of paganism with Christianity, and set the church on the highway that would mold 14 centuries of European life and thought. But Constantine would be best remembered for introducing a secular form of authority into the church. One example is the authority bishops were given as judges in their dioceses. The groundwork had been laid for the future controversies between spiritual and temporal power. The Bishop of Rome became more prominent than any other lay or ecclesiastical figure in the West. It is from the 4th century and Constantine, and especially with the fall of the Roman Empire, that the papacy begins to assume its secular importance and the position which it held into the Middle Ages. Another effect initiated by Constantine was to have emperors call church councils. Constantine himself called a council in 325, and it would eventually result in what we know as the Nicene Creed. The same council also affirmed the organization and survival of the church. Succeeding popes like Leo I, a century later, would build upon that unanimity and make the succession from St. Peter the foundation argument in favor of Roman primacy. Peter acts, speaks, judges, and continues to live in and through the pope. The Peter-Pope identity survives to the present day. Another factor that influenced the way the role of the papacy developed was the donation of Pepin in 756. Pepin III, King of the Franks, gave Pope Stephen II some captured Italian cities, which laid the foundations of the Papal States. This made Stephen the first pope to be a temporal ruler, but also allowed Pepin to constitute himself and his successors patrons and protectors of the Holy See. Pepin would be succeeded by his son Charlemagne, who was crowned by Pope Leo III in the year 800, effectively, as they say, sending a message that no man could be an accepted emperor of the West without anointing by the Pope. For the next five centuries, this new papal authority would be consolidated over all Christians, rulers and subjects alike. Never would the supremacy of the Bishop of Rome be more accepted and acknowledged than it was during this period. The 10th century brought with it real problems for the papacy. At that time, the Bishop of Rome was elected by the Roman clergy, the nobles, and the populace. It was a difficult period for the papacy, with 25 popes elected over a period of 100 years. It was a time of interference in the work of the pope by nobles and emperors. By the end of the century, there was an obvious need for institutional reform within the church. In the 11th century, there appeared on the scene a strong pope known as Gregory VII. He undertook the reforms needed to restore the prestige of the church. Previous to his election as pope, Gregory had already begun the process of transferring the election of the pope to the College of Cardinals, thereby rescuing the papacy from Roman nobles and German emperors. As pope, he proclaimed authority over bishops, clerics and councils, kings and emperors. Pope Gregory VII was thoroughly intent upon reform, even to the point of deposing Emperor Henry IV of Germany for failing to carry out reforms in his domains. Everyone was subject to the authority of the pope, even an emperor. Thus, Gregory VII exercised and strengthened his role of supremacy among his brother bishops. The greatest civilizing force in medieval European history had made the states and kings of Europe accountable for their actions. Not all of them were happy about it. In the 14th and 15th centuries, the popes increasingly found themselves at the mercy of their councils, their cardinals, and the kings and emperors of Europe. Sometimes they even found themselves sharing the papacy with somebody else. At one point, there were actually three persons claiming to be popes, all ruling at the same time. In 1415, the Council of Constance deposed all three, and in so doing asserted the supremacy of general councils over the popes. This came to be known as conciliarism, which was seen as a threat to papal power. Everybody, it seemed, wanted authority. Councils tried to reform the church but were defeated by the popes, who were in turn defeated by their cardinals. Added to the growing tensions between conciliar authority and papal authority were abuses of various kinds which had crept into the church. The time was ripe for reform. The Reformation was at hand. When Martin Luther tacked his 95 Theses on the church door at Wittenberg in 1517, he unwittingly unleashed the pent-up frustrations and resentments of ruler and ruled alike. One focus of their resentment was the exercise of papal authority. However, cooler heads never lost sight of where the real problems in the church lay. Erasmus of Rotterdam advised Luther that it might be wiser of you to denounce those who misuse the pope's authority than to censure the pope himself. Luther himself was not without sympathy for the plight of the pope during this great religious upheaval. He wrote Leo X, saying, "I have always grieved, most excellent Leo, that thou hast been made pope in these times, for thou wert worthy of better days." Better days would come soon after at the Council of Trent in 1545, which would claim authority for both church tradition and scripture. While papal religious authority would emerge stronger and enlarged, the political prestige of the papacy continued to decline for the next two centuries as the popes tried to adapt to a less influential role in international disputes. Finally, the church was drawn into the faith-reason controversies of the 1700s. The Enlightenment questioned the existence of God. This created insecurity among a large part of the lay faithful. They turned back to the church for guidance and authority, The papacy was on the threshold of a momentous resurgence in popularity and influence, but it would take a revolution to do it. When French rebels stormed the Bastille on July 14, 1789, they set in motion a decade of developments that would reverberate well into the present century. You see, those who took power tried to replace religion with rationalism, worship of the state as a substitute for religion. The Cathedral of Notre Dame was even renamed the Temple of Reason. Well, this was bound to backfire on them, and it did, turning the country against the revolution. Most of the people found there was no substitute for the sacraments, ceremonies, and processional holy days. As one writer of the time remarked, somewhat tongue-in-cheek, the Christian Sunday was flagrantly respected and enjoyed. It was in this context of rising church popularity that Napoleon, for reasons known only to himself, decided to make a move on the Papal States, those lands in central Italy given to Pope Stephen II by Pepin, King of the Franks, over 1,000 years previous. Napoleon had managed to conquer North and South Italy, but wanted all of Italy under his control. However, the church insisted on keeping the Papal State ports open to British commerce. In exasperation, Napoleon invaded Rome and the Papal States in 1806, and made Pope Pius VII a prisoner. At this, the French clergy and people rose up in defense of their pontiff and their creed. He was, by most reports, much loved by believer and non-believer alike. Napoleon's imprisonment of Pius VII served to strengthen the papacy, and the French Catholic Church once more gave its loyalty and reverence to it. The temporal power of the papacy was restored on the return of the Papal States following Napoleon's defeat in 1814. The quiet resistance of the imprisoned Pius VII increased the spiritual influence of the papacy, and his reign marks a transition between the troubles of the French Revolution and the quiet pontificates that were to follow. It is from this time we see an upswing in papal spiritual leadership. A pronounced trend towards centralization of ecclesiastical administrative power in Rome, and the unquestioned exercise of papal primacy throughout the church. A combination of factors, social, political, and spiritual, would culminate in the First Vatican Council in 1869. The years leading up to Vatican I saw the rise of liberalism. This was not only a philosophical or political phenomenon, but a state of mind that took a critical attitude to tradition and convention. The church had seen the results of misguided liberalism in the French Revolution, which saw hundreds of monasteries confiscated, churches desecrated, and clergy expelled. As well, there was growing restlessness from rising nationalism. It seemed the time for the church to once more exert firm leadership. Catholics in persecuted situations looked to Rome for help. A strong centralized authority was needed. These needs helped to give rise to the First Vatican Council, which was held in 1869 and 1870. The main questions which arose at the council centered around two things, the supremacy of the Pope and his infallibility. First, was the Bishop of Rome seen to be the first among all the bishops of the Catholic Church? That is, was he supreme? Was he preeminent? Yes. All 700 of the bishops present at the council agreed on this point. Just as Peter was head of the apostles, so too was the Pope the first among the bishops. The second question, however, was not so easily resolved. This question was, is the Pope infallible? That is he preserved from speaking error, from saying what is untrue? The answer to this question was more than just yes or no. It was first, under what conditions? Is the Pope infallible by himself, or in collegiality with the universal episcopate? Second, in what areas is the Pope infallible? Is he infallible in everything from faith to politics? And third, how must he make his infallible statements? Is he infallible every time he speaks? The final outcome of the council was what is called the definition of papal infallibility. Yes, the Pope is infallible, but only in matters of faith and morals, and only when speaking ex cathedra, that is, only when he uses a specific solemn formula. Because the Pope expresses the belief of the Church in her tradition, he must be in touch with the Church. How this is to be done was not discussed. The discussion of the infallibility of the Church as a whole and the relationship of collegiality to papal authority will have to wait till a later time. It was Vatican II, almost a century later, that began to put into focus our understanding of the collegiality of the bishops and the role played by the whole people of God. If Vatican I was centralized spiritual power, Vatican II was shared spiritual power. Under the guidance of Popes John XXIII and Paul VI, Vatican II sought a balanced approach to papal and episcopal authority, otherwise known as collegiality. It also emphasized the pastoral quality of church ministry, a sacramental and ecumenical vision of church, lay participation, and a ministry based on service. This collegial approach to authority within the Church is an attempt to see the Pope less as an independent monarch and more as a fellow bishop. It rests on the ancient idea of communio, a united people participating in God's saving grace in Christ. Collegiality, then, is based on both Scripture and tradition. The majority of theologians today see the supreme authority of the Church as the Episcopal College with papal leadership. That is simply, all the bishops of the world together with the Pope at their head. Legally, the bishops do not have to be consulted before Rome issues a statement affecting the whole Church. Like the Church itself, collegiality, or the sharing of leadership, is under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. However, the complexities facing the Church today make collaboration imperative. It's hard to imagine a Pope speaking on matters of doctrine without having first consulted with his fellow bishops. Ecumenically, the idea of collegiality has made the papacy more acceptable to other churches and better enables the Pope to become, in the words of Vatican I, the pastor and teacher of all Christians. This new papal image is emphasized by the reception he receives from members of all faiths on his journeys throughout the world. He comes to them not as a symbol of authority, but of service. The years of Vatican II, 1962 to 1965, saw the Catholic Church express itself as an outgiving, world-embracing community of faith. It was not only an outward renewal vis-a-vis the world, but an inward renewal vis-a-vis the Church herself. So as we look back over the centuries, we can see that papal authority has gone through different stages. From St. Peter to Constantine, we see it in its pastoral infancy, fighting for its spiritual survival. From Constantine to the French Revolution, we have a papacy which gradually grows in power, not only spiritual, but also social and political. And from Vatican I to Vatican II, we see a papacy of doctrine, discipline, and authority. And today? Today, we enjoy a papacy that better reflects the internationalism of the Church, a papacy reaching to heal division, a papacy in transition from a more monarchical model to one of fellowship and service. The collegial approach makes more clear that the Pope expresses the faith of the Church. He does not teach anything other than what the Church believes, a faith already present and expressed in Scripture and in the documents of tradition. It is a papacy on the move, trying to adapt to the pluralistic needs of the world faith community. In short, a papacy by its own historical experience, trying to heal the hurts of a divided world. We're indebted to several people for their help in putting this particular program together. Special mention should go to theologian Dr. David Louch, a Redemptorist priest, historian Dr. Faye Tremblay, a Sister of Charity of the Immaculate Conception, and ecumenist and educator Barbara Rice, a Sister for Christian Community. And thanks to you for watching. I'm Barry Hawkins. In his nearly 6 years as Pope, John Paul II has made an extraordinary effort to bring the gospel to the world. This itinerant evangelist, on behalf of Christian values, has traveled to dozens of countries over many continents in his belief that a bishop must stand in the midst of his people as one who serves. It is clear that John Paul believes there is no substitute for on-the-spot witness. In imitation of the Apostle Paul, he travels to confirm the Christian faith and to promote the needs of faith and the affirmation of various human needs. How else can one explain the enthusiastic reception John Paul has received in almost all the places he has visited? People see him as believable, a man of deep faith who generates the same spirit in others. People can identify with him and are attracted by his friendly style. To many of them, he is one of the family. But it's not just the worldwide Roman Catholic family of 750 million people. It's the millions upon millions of non-Catholics, believers and unbelievers alike, who look to John Paul to speak for them and address their concerns that many times cross all denominational boundaries. How can you put a religious label on suffering, hunger, oppression, war, unemployment, nuclear weapons? That is why the papal ministry of John Paul reflects a concern for all, believers and unbelievers, who belong to the human family. He spares no effort to be a friend and a servant of humanity. Some may not agree with how he goes about it, and that's to be expected and welcomed. It is from just such differences that meaningful dialogue can take place and lead us all farther along the road to a profound renewal of the most noble Christian and human values. Human dignity is central to the teaching of John Paul. His interest in human rights and responsibilities may well reflect his own experiences during the German occupation of Poland in World War II and the subsequent communist takeover after Hitler's defeat by the Allies. The basis of his theory of human dignity is the mystery of Christ. "In our inmost being, Christ has recreated us," he said in New York, "reconciled us with God, reconciled us with ourselves, reconciled us with our brothers and sisters." Because we are created in the image of God, it is imperative we see God in others and recognize their incomparable dignity. Therefore, human life is sacred, and every person is of immense worth. Drawing on these ideas, the Pope speaks out forcefully in defense of human freedom and the inviolability of human rights. He condemns any individual, program, system, or government that exploits or neglects fundamental human rights. He has strong words for both capitalists and Marxists, for those who practice or condone violence, or who destroy the environment. He is the champion of the poor and oppressed. For that reason, even his critics applaud his firm and courageous stand on social justice, for it seems to be in the area of social justice that they and he appear to find common ground.
I would say, I guess you're picking up on something we left behind before, I would say that that is where we're in the most agreement, is in the social justice areas, the concern about nuclear disarmament, the concern for peace, the concern for having, that we live in hope, in freedom, all of those issues, the Presbyterians, I would say, would be right in line with what the Pope says.
The United Church has traditionally been involved in a concern for native rights and has an active ongoing committee dealing with land and aboriginal rights in terms of land, etc., and is concerned around unemployment, presented a brief to the McDonald Commission when it was here, so those are things in which ecumenically we're dealing, and as a matter of fact, there is an ecumenical committee established in this province which is representative of a number of denominations, and those are two of the issues that we have dealt with just recently.
This sense of concern, Christian compassion, is shared by Archbishop Joseph McNeil of Edmonton.
I think one of the themes that he and I talked about that I think he would really like to share across the country, but that's the whole notion of, you know, the compassion of the Lord, the concern that the Lord has for us, for all His people, and this whole notion that He has brought into the Holy Year, the reaching out to people who feel alienated, who feel cut off, who feel that no one is interested. And, you know, that's what Jesus came to do, to reach out to people who felt cut off from God and maybe even from others. So that whole notion of redemption, reconciliation. But it is at base a notion of love, of compassion, of concern. And that's so much part of this person, of Pope John Paul II. And I feel that in many ways this will come out in his talks.
Many of his talks during his Cross Canada tour will deal with social justice issues. John Paul is expected to speak on Northern Native rights, the impact of technology, Canada and Third World relations, and world peace. It's expected he will affirm the Church's commitment in these areas and encourage each of us to greater awareness, just like a previous visitor to Alberta in June of 1982.
You know, we have a bit of an inkling of that in the visit we had from Mother Teresa of Calcutta. I think she touched many, many people in a beautiful way. I think the Pope John Paul II would do the same thing. I think that our opportunity of sharing him with other people, you know, it'll be a visit to all the people in Alberta and really Saskatchewan and part of the North. So we're sharing him in a way, our great gift, our great leader is being shared. And I think that will, as you indicated earlier, my expression of bringing us to a certain degree of maturity, I think that the fact that we will pray together the evening prayer on the Sunday evening at the cathedral, that we will have our clergy from all over the province and from Saskatchewan, that we will have representatives of the religious women, that we will have representatives of the various denominations, various religions, and to be led in prayer by the Pope. To me, I think that's just going to be a beautiful experience for us, and I think it will help us understand, probably in a very forceful way, how important it is for us to pray together.
Praying together. Who can forget that moving scene during Christmas week of 1983 in a Rome jail, where John Paul publicly and privately forgave the man who shot him in May of 1981 in St. Peter's Square? The message was clear. If John Paul could forgive Mehmet Ali Aksha, we too could forgive and reach out to those from whom we may have been estranged or separated. I talked to him, the Pope later told reporters, as I would speak to a brother whom I have forgiven and who enjoys my complete trust. And once again, we were reminded how fragile is the strongest man and how dependent he is on the providence of God, and how dangerous it is to be a visible sign of hope in a world seemingly intent upon destroying itself. We saw it in 1965 when Pope Paul VI traveled to the United Nations to plead for an end to war and for nuclear disarmament. He spoke not just for the worldwide Catholic community, but for all of us who share these concerns for world peace. John Paul's public and private support of Solidarity, the first independent trade union in the communist bloc, spoke to the hearts of all of those everywhere struggling for freedom and dignity against repressive governments, whether it be in Poland or the Philippines or in Central or South America. Their struggle was his struggle, and their hurt was his hurt. His spiritual leadership is recognized by churches the world over, and Canadian churches are no different, although some are not as enthusiastic as others.
Well, we recognize and acknowledge that the Pope is the spiritual leader of the Roman Catholic Church. We can't relate to the Pope as other than a person, a church leader. We don't have anything, anybody, that's regarded in the same way in the United Church as the Pope is for the Roman Catholics. I think that we admire a person who will take on that particular role. It takes a lot of courage to be Pope. It's a risky job. Ecumenically, we respect the Pope as the leader of the Roman Catholic community, and have had good relations with the Roman Catholic community. United Church is the United Church of Canada, and so it's not international. It's limited to Canada, and so we don't have the same contacts with the Vatican, say, that Lutheran Church would have, or the Anglican Church would have, which is more international in scope. So we have limited contacts there, and when we talk about ecumenical relations with the Roman Catholic Church, we're thinking of the bishops and the people in our own country, in Canada.
I would see the Pope as being a sign of spirituality, the other dimension of every person held up for us to see visibly in a person, okay? Is a symbol or a sign of the issues that we all have to struggle with, the very important issues. I don't always, and a lot of Presbyterians are not going to agree with what the Pope says, but I don't think there'd be many of us who would disagree with him being the sign of hope in a sometimes very hopeless world, a sign of spiritual charisma in the man himself, and that he represents all things that all human beings are struggling towards, the perfection of the earth, the perfection of men and women, and that struggle. We don't share the same struggle with him. We wouldn't get from here to there the same way, all right? But I don't think I'd be out of line to say that we are all trying and reaching to what he represents, regardless of what he actually says.
I think we would see him as being a denominational leader and not so much as representative of the total Christian community. A representative in the total Christian community, yes. But I think that we would see it as confined within the bounds of the Roman Catholic faith and not not representing Christianity as a whole to the world.
The Reverend Edward Scott, Primate of the Anglican Church of Canada, has been quoted as encouraging the Pope to speak on strong family life, one of John Paul's favorite themes, but not to adopt what Reverend Scott feels are rigid positions, but rather to encourage sensitivity to the complexities of life. The Reverend Clark MacDonald, moderator of the United Church in Canada, would like the Pope to address the question of women in the church. Unlike many churches, the Catholic Church does not ordain women as priests. Women's ordination is of great concern to many in Canada's faith community.
Well, within the United Church, we have had ordination of women for many years. And find it hard, we find it painful to think of our sisters in the Roman Catholic faith who would want to be ordained, but who are not able to be. We don't understand why that can't be.
How has the United Church been enriched by the increased role of women within the church?
Women have always had a very major role, although it's been a quieter, low-key role. It's been for many years the same kind of role that mothers and wives played in the home. That is the kind of sustaining, nurturing, maintaining role. That's changing very much in the United Church. Women are have integrated, I think, all levels of the church, not to the extent that we would like and that we hope will come, but our past moderator of the United Church was Lois Wilson. And this year, across the conferences in our United Church, four of the 13 conferences are presided over by women. So that women are taking more visible upfront leadership roles. And we're finding that leadership qualities aren't determined on by sex, but they're determined by the characteristics of individuals. And so the women, some women make great leaders and some make great sustainers. Some men make great leaders and some make great sustainers. Mm-hmm.
The president of the Canada section of the Lutheran Church in America has joined with others in emphasizing the Pope's moral leadership, but stops short of agreeing with the Pope's stand on issues like birth control and abortion. It was in this context that I asked Reverend Armstrong whether there was any subject she would rather the Pope did not talk about.
I don't know if I would really want to say what he should say. I think I would want him to be authentic and be himself, and say what is on his mind and not fudge, and even though we would disagree with him, I'd rather have somebody who I knew where they stood, and we can disagree, then you can have dialogue, but somebody who sort of fudges and, you know, makes things very fuzzy and is very diplomatic, I don't think is necessarily helpful for anybody in order not to have disagreement. I don't think disagreement is necessarily unhealthy. I think some ways it's a very good thing. I think in the process of disagreeing and trying to work through those disagreements is where the church will get somewhere.
I would hope that we're a country where you wouldn't have to say, hey, don't talk about that when you go to Canada. And maybe I've got my head in the sand. I remember the reaction when de Gaulle said, you know, vive le Quebec libre. So I suppose on internal matters we could be pretty sensitive, but I think we should be strong enough to be able to hear from outside of our own country some comments about how we're viewed.
But differences there are, and most of them revolve around the notion of papal infallibility. It's a sensitive area that we explored in the television studio one summer evening with Bishop Don Schoberg of the Lutheran Church in America, Father Tom James of the Anglican Church, and Father Martin Moser of the Catholic Church.
Well, I think what we have discovered is that each church has their own way of preserving the truth. And in the Roman Catholic Church, that's very much related to the papacy. And in our own church, it's related to our confessions, the church conventions, and so forth. And I think what's important to understand is that it's the preserving of the truth is a dynamic thing. It's not static. And to recognize the power of the Holy Spirit at work in the church by whatever means in order to preserve that truth, to give that truth some new meaning in today's world.
How does the Lutheran Church look at the Pope?
we're struggling with this, and as a result of the round of dialogues, we have been asked to a very interesting question by our representatives and by our Roman brothers and sisters. Do we see the possibility of seeing the Pope as in a renewed way as a servant of the gospel and to help preserve the unity of the church? Is it possible for us to see the papacy in a new way?
A symbol of service rather than a government, would that?
That's right. That's
Tom?
Right.
It's rather interesting that in the dialogue that's gone on for the last 12 years internationally between the Anglican Communion and the Roman Catholic Church, two of the four major papers have been on the question of authority. And we look at the papacy in the context of the necessity of there being authority in the common life of the church. Now, just to illustrate how far we have come in our thinking in 400 years, in the Second Anglican Prayer Book of 1559, there was a delightful petition in the litany which said, "From the tyranny of the Bishop of Rome and all his detestable enormities, good Lord, deliver us." Yeah. So to have the Bishop of Rome standing in Canterbury Cathedral, reaffirming his baptismal vows with the Archbishop of Canterbury, is to say that the question of the papacy has certainly, in 400 years, moved a long way in a direction of acceptance. we recognize the need for there to be authority in the church. And authority, however collegial it may be at the level of the bishops, nonetheless, there must be, as we say of the Archbishop of Canterbury, first among equals. And there must be the person who can articulate the faith of the church as agreed to by collegiality. And we would be quite prepared to see the Bishop of Rome, whom we recognize has historical primacy, as that particular spokesman.
Just how far we've come, Martin, is the fact that the Catholic Church can sit down and discuss the role of papal infallibility and even consider a different term, Bishop of Rome. What does this say to you?
Well, first of all, I think there's no doubt, you know, that the role of the papacy and our own understanding of the role of the papacy in Roman Catholicism is the major difficulty in the ecumenical discussion at the present time and in the past 10 years. And that is also the point of division, especially between the Roman Catholic Church and the Orthodox churches. I think that one thing it's important to do is to be able to distinguish various ways in which the exercise of the leadership of popes in the Christian tradition has occurred, and then what is really the essential, you know, of what we believe this leadership must be. And so the ways in which the leadership of the Pope has been exercised, this can change.
So if we can get over that, I'd like to use the word problem, but if that can be resolved, that would be a big step then, would it?
That's right. But then when we get down to what is the essential faith that we express in the leadership of the ministry of Peter, well, that's where the ecumenical dialogue has to continue to study, reflect, and go forward. And I personally think that a great deal of openness has certainly been shown. And also, we Roman Catholics have to continue to reflect on how we understand this more fully for today and the future in terms of church unity.
And now, John Paul comes to Canada to help foster the church unity that Jesus Christ so wished for us, that we all be one. Through his words and actions, John Paul will challenge us, and as he has so many times before in so many other countries, leave us feeling a little better for having shared a few special moments with him. There will still be disagreement with his position on women's ordination, interpersonal relationships, and even the role of the Pope itself in the 20th century. However, most all would agree, Catholic and non-Catholic, believer and unbeliever, that John Paul is a visible Christian witness in a world badly in need of healing, a world that welcomes the compassion and hope this man of faith represents. It's a world looking for spiritual leadership, and this man helps to give it, Pope John Paul II. I'm Barry Hawkins.